نعم.
وعن الثاني ما أخرجه عن اسم الماء المطلق من المغيرات الطاهرة، ولا فرق بين قليل وكثير وما فوق القلتين وما دونهما ومستعمل وغير مستعمل ومتحرك وساكن. فصل في.
The author rahimahullah here, he goes into that. So two things, brothers, I want you to pay attention to, that can make the water lose these two descriptions. That's what he wants to do. Two things, they can make the water no longer be either tahir or mutahir simultaneously, and that is when impurity falls in it. If the impure things fall into the water and they change the fragrance or the color or the scent or the taste, are we all together? This water, and what made the taste change, or what made the smell change, or the color change, is something which is impure. Some urinated inside the water and it now looks yellow. Methylene. This water is najis. What is it? Najis. La tahirun. It is not tahir, nor is it mutahir. So it loses those two descriptions that it used to have. What about if what falls into it is a pure thing? The author is saying, the thing that falls into it, that changes the color now, like a tea bag, it takes away from this water what? It takes away from this mutahir. It doesn't take away tahir. It takes mutahir from it. It's tahir because you can drink it if you want to. You can have it. But it's not mutahir, meaning it doesn't do raf'ul hadathi wa izalati najas. Now the author, rahimahullah, goes into another issue, which is, does it really matter the quantity of the water? The author says, وَلَا فَرْقَ بَيْنَ قَلِيلٍ أَوْ كَثِيرٍ. It doesn't matter whether that water is little or a lot. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. If the water is little or a lot, it doesn't matter. Some scholars, they said, yes, it is. There's a difference. Sorry. Shawkani, there's a difference. And then within themselves, the ones who said it matters whether it's a little or a lot, فَاخْتَلَفُوا فِيمَا بَيْنَهُمْ. Then they themselves differed, okay, what is a little and what is a lot? Shafi'iyah, they took the opinion that what is little or a lot is مَا فَوْقَ الْقُلَّتَيْنِ وَمَا دُونَهُمَا. Shafi'iyah, this is where they stood off. They said this is our distinguishing factor, whether this water is little or a lot, is the concept of al-qullatayn. And the word qullatayn, or qullatan, is tathniyatu qullah. It's the dual of qullah. Are we all together? And then within themselves, they differed what's the measurement of a qullah. They differed amongst themselves. Some of them, they said, the qulla is 160 litran. Some of them, they said, it is 160 liters. And some of them, they said, it's 200 liters. And some of them, they said, it's 250 liters. And some of them, they said, it is 275 liters. And some of them even said 300 liters of water. So they differed, even the Shafi'iyya, فِيمَا بَيْنَهُمْ. What is the measurement of what? Qulla. What is the qullatan? How much is it? And so here the scholars, they said, them differing upon the concept of qullatani, what it is and the amount it is, and their iddirab of this whole issue, and the fact that it's not known, shows that this is not something that the Sharia actually wants us to give in consideration. Something which is ghayra muhaddad. There can't be a tahdeed placed on it. They said this is... Not to mention the ahadith that the Shafi'iyya used, إِذَا بَلَغَ الْمَاءِ. If the water reaches قُلَّتَيْن, لَمْ يَنْجُسْ أَمَا لَمْ يُنَجِّسْهُ شَيْءٍ. Many of the scholars, they weaken this hadith. And they said this hadith is what? It is weak. Are we all together, brothers? And some scholars, they said, no, it's actually not weak unrestrictedly, لكنه ضعيف في رفعه إلى رسول الله. To attribute it to the Prophet is ضعيف. أما وقفه إلى ابن عمر فصحيح. As for if it stopped to Ibn Umar, then it's صحيح. Are we all together, brothers? This mas'ala, it requires a long discussion. Itself will take hours to talk about. We'll leave it for now. ومتحرك وساكن. The author says, it doesn't matter to me whether the water is little or a lot. وَمَا فَوْقَ الْقُلَّتَيْنِ وَمَا دُونَهُمَا. Whether it's above قُلَّتَيْنِ or whether it's below قُلَّتَيْنِ, it doesn't matter. Shawkani said, وَمُتَحَرِّكٍ وَسَاكِنٍ. Whether that water is moving or whether it's still water, he said, it doesn't matter. To him, this is all the same. It is what? All the same. Some of the scholars, they took the opinion that it is not permissible to purify yourself with still water, water that's still. And they used the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's narrated in Sahih Muslim, min hadith Abi Huraira, that the Prophet said, لا يغتسل أحدكم في الماء الدائم وهو جنوب. لا يغتسل. The scholars, they say, it's a nahy, it's a prohibition. يراد منها النفي. I'm a nephew, sorry. Some scholars, they said, nahi is intended from it. And some scholars, they said, no, it's not. Ala kulli hal, this hadith shows that it's impermissible to urinate in still water and that you're not allowed. Are we all together? So what do? Abu Huraira was asked. If there's water in somewhere, do you go in? He said, no. يَتَنَاوَلُهُ تَنَاوُلًا. Go and take the water from the side with a bucket and use it somewhere else. Don't go inside the water. So you can use the water, but you can't go inside it. وَمُسْتَعْمَلٍ وَغَيْرِ مُسْتَعْمَلٍ. The author goes into a mas'ala sadisa. This is another sixth mas'ala. He said it doesn't matter whether that water is a used water or not. Whether the water is used or not, the author, rahimahullah, he said it doesn't matter to me. خُلَاسَةُ هَذَا الْبَابِ. The summary of this chapter now. Write this down. Summary of everything. The unrestricted water, it's pure in and within itself and it purifies. The unrestricted water is pure in and within itself and it can purify. Point number two. The water, it can be mixed with something that is impure or something that is pure. And if what is mixed with it is pure, if what is mixed with it is pure water, then we look at whether it changed the three factors. The smell, the scent, the taste, or the color. If it didn't change any of those three, then that water, you can still use it. Something pure fell into it. It wasn't able to change any of those three. Then you can use that water to purify yourself. رَفْعُ الْحَدَثِ وَإِزَالَةُ النَّجَاسَةِ. And if it changes any of those three, that pure thing that fell into the water, if it changes anything of it, then it is pure in and within itself, but it can't purify. As for if something impure falls into the water and it changes the three, something impure fell into it and it changes one of the three, then that water is najas. It's a water which is impure. You cannot utilize it in any way, shape or form. So you can't drink it. You can't use it for other things. Also, you cannot use it for raf'u al-hadathi wa izalatu al-najasa. It's impure water. You can't use it. It's of no value for you anymore. But what about if it doesn't change any of the three? So something impure fell into it and it doesn't change the three, then that water is tahirun and mutahir. If the impure fell into it and it doesn't change it, then that water is pure in and within itself and it purifies others. Whether that water is a lot or little, it doesn't matter. And as a side benefit, when it comes to the chapter of Ilmiyyah, the best madhab in that regard is madhab imami, al-imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-imam Malik's fiqh and his views in Babul Miyah is the best. Hatta al-imam al-Ghazali, who is from the A'imatu al-Shafi'iyah, he said, waditu, He said this in his Kitab al-Wasit. He's a Shafi'i, hardcore Shafi'i. Al-Imam al-Ghazali. He said, "Wadittu, I wish, لو أن مذهب الشافعي في المياه كان كمذهب مالك." I wish that Al-Imam Shafi'i's madhab would be like the madhab of Al-Imam Malik in what? In the chapter of Miyah. ولذلك the madhab of Imam Malik رحمه الله is the aswab in the Bab al-Miyah. It's closer to the Dalil and it's so organized. The chapter of. And also, madhabuhu fil buyuh. Madhab al-Imam Malik is the best when it comes to buyuh. Are we all together, brothers? So don't be a mutaassib for a particular madhab just because you, your people are that madhab or you're from that madhab. You can see that Imam Malik madhab in buyuh and al-Ilmiyyah, amazing. Naam.
فصل في أنواع النجاسات والنجاسات هي غائط الإنسان مطلقا وبوله إلا الذكر الرضيع
والعوث رحمه الله هي he says النجاسات brothers النجاسات في اللغة هي القذر أن الشرع كل عين يجب التطهر منها مثل البول والبزار the نجاسة is anything that one has to purify himself from such as urine, feces, and things like that. So najasa, it's ayn. Ayn, brother means brothers mean what? You can see. Ayn here doesn't mean eye, but it means something that's tangible, that can be touched, that can be seen. Are we all together? Here, brothers, before we go into details, we have to open this chapter with a very important qa'ida, which is al-aslu fil ashya'i tahara. The default position for everything is what? Purification. Everything is tahir. Until what? فَإِذَا جَاءَ دَلِيلٌ نَاقِلٌ عَنْ ذَلِكَ الْأَصْلِ أُخِذَ بِهِ And if we find a evidence that removes something from its impurity, something from its purity, then it becomes impure. And then the asal is everything is tahir. Then the sharia comes and says, this is, what about this is not tahir, this is not tahir, this is not tahir. We'll accept it then. So the asal of things is tahara. So Shawkani, we will look at the things that he mentions under the najasat. We'll look at them. If he brings anything from the najasat that there is no evidence for, we'll say Shaykh is wrong in this issue. We don't take it from him. لأن the qa'idah that we're using is the istishab, بقاء ما كان على ما كان. We're using the qa'idah which is the default position, which is everything is pure until proven otherwise. And what is it that can prove it otherwise? It's a dalil min al-kitabi aw al-sunnati aw al-ijma'. Are we all together? Very good. The author, rahimahullah, then mentions some things that are impure. Some things which are impure. They themselves are impure. So if they go on their clothing, if they go on a place that you want to pray, or if they go on your body. By the way, the a'yad, the najasat, they go in three places, the najasat. The first thing that they go on is your bedan, your body, and I mentioned that. And they go on your thawb, which is your clothing, or they go on the makan, a place that you want to pray in, or a place. All together. Those are the three spots, the three places. Okay. The first thing that the author, rahimahullah, mentioned here, غَائِطُ الْإِنسَانِ. The first thing that he mentioned is the feces. The author mentioned it. The word غائط, according to the Arab, are we all together, brothers? It's the terms which the scholars refer to as majaz. And they call it majazun naql. You all know majazun naql, I think we took it in waraqat. Is that when a word used to have a particular usage, and then now it gets taken away from that its original usage and it becomes another usage. The word غائط, according to the Arab, before it used to be matma'anna min al-ardi. It's when the earth is down. The land that is down, that used to be known as غائط. The down earth. Now the earth is leveled. This is a part where it goes down. That's where it ever goes down. And the reason why they're called غائط is because when the person would go to do his call of nature, he would go to that land which is a bit down so that the people can't see him. Are we all together? And so now the action of going to the call of nature became called ghayat. Are we all together? It became called ghayat. That's what the Arabs used to call it before. The ghayat, brothers, is impure. And it's impure by ittifaq, by unanimous agreement. Meaning, the mas'ala is ijma', is a consensus. There is no difference of opinion. And I'm just going to bring one imam that brought an ijma' that the feces is impure. And his name is Ibn Hazm. In his kitab Maratib al-Ijma', he says, وَاتَّفَقُوا. The scholars are unanimously in agreement. عَلَى أَنَّ بَوْلَ ابْنَ آدَمِ إِذَا كَانَ كَثِيرًا وَلَمْ يَكُنْ كَرَؤُوسِ الْإِبْرِ وَغَائِطُهُ نَجَسٌ. The last part is what concerns us now, is وَغَائِطُهُ نَجَسٌ. And the human feces is impure. And he said this is by consensus of the scholars, ijma'. So two scholars haven't differed on this particular issue. Okay? And we believe, the brothers, that the ijma', the consensus, is a dalilun min adillati shara'. It is one of the evidences in our religion that we must take. So this is important that we understand that. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in a hadith, إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدُكُمْ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ فَلْيَنْظُرْ. If one of you comes to the masjid, let him look at. Look at what? Let him look at his shoes and what he's wearing. The shoes that you're wearing, or your flip-flops, or your sandals. Look at it. فَإِنْ رَأَى فِي نَعْلِهِ قَذِرًا أو أَذَى. If you see impurities or a filth on your sandals or on your shoes, فَلْيَمْسَحْهُ. Wipe it on the ground. وَلْيُصَلِّ فِيهِمَا. Then pray on it. Okay? Remember what I said before? The khabath, the najasa, is cleaned in three ways. صح? The first one I said is ghaslin, is washed. And the evidence for that is the Arabi, the Bedouin man that came to the masjid. فَبَالَ فِي طَائِفَةِ الْمَسْجِدِ. He urinated in the side of the masjid. And the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَامُ عَلَيْهِ said, أَهْرِقُوا عَلَيْهِ مَاءً. Go and pour a danuba min ma'. Go and pour a bucket of water over there. So that was washing it. Okay? Also, masḥ. Masḥ means to wipe. It's the second way of cleaning a najasa. You might wipe it, like on your shoes. And the third one is nadḥ. We're going to see it, inshallah. The urine of the child, the boy. Okay? That you sprinkle water over it. That's another way of that's cleaning a ayn of najasa. And then, brothers, the place that the Sharia tells us to wash, we wash it. The place that the Sharia tells us to wipe, we wipe it. The place that the Sharia tells us to sprinkle water, we sprinkle water. And we will not be from the ones who will wash where the Sharia told us to sprinkle. Because that will be ghulu. It'll be extreme in what the Sharia didn't say, put that in there. We all together. The author, rahimahullah, he said, so we mentioned the evidence for the urine. We mentioned the evidences for the ghaid. Mutlaqan, unrestrictedly. Wabawlahu, and the urine. The urine, we also mentioned the evidence for it. That the urine is impure and it needs cleaning. That the Arabi man who urinated in the masjid, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told that his urine gets washed. The Prophet then sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he washed it and the water was poured over it, the Prophet ﷺ left it like that. He didn't go to the companions and say, dig the earth and then put the sand at the bottom of the earth to the top. He didn't. Rather, when he did ﷺ, tell them to pour a bucket of water over the urine, the Prophet said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ. I was sent out, the Prophet said to them, مُيَسِّرِينَ. One who makes matters easy for the people. وَلَمْ تُبْعَثُوا مُعَسِّرِينَ. And you guys were not sent, including himself, you were not sent out to make things hard on the people. Okay? That's the second thing that the author mentioned that is impure. The first one was غَائِطُ الْإِنسَانِ مُطْلَقًا. The second one is وَبَوْلُهُ, the urine of the humans. And the third one is إِلَّا الذَّكَرُ الرَّضِيعُ. Now we want to go into the urine of a child who's breastfed. Okay? The scholars and the people of knowledge, أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ, اِخْتَلَفُوا فِي بَوْلِ الرَّضِيعُ. The scholars differed amongst themselves when it comes to the urine of the child that is breastfed. وَالصَّحِيحُ, that which seems authentic. Again, I said there is a difference of opinion, but the strongest opinion is that it's impure. Okay? But that being said, The Shari', meaning Allah Azza wa Jalla, He made it easy when it came to cleaning the urine of the boy. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was more, both of them are impure, but he was more what? Easier on the boy's one. There's a hadith, Umm Qais radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, أنها أتت, she came, بابن لها, a child, a son that she had. لم يبلغ, this child never reached, أن يأكل الطعام, to eat food. فبال في حجر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the child, the boy, he was breastfed, he never ate food yet. And he urinated in the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's lap, عليه الصلاة والسلام. فدعا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بماء. The Prophet called for some water. What did he do? فنضحه, and then he sprinkled that water على ثوبه, on his clothing. ولم يغسله غسلا. And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did not wash it. Okay. So here, what the Prophet did was sprinkle. The word نضحه, it means a رش عليه الماء. He sprinkled some water over it. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. And there's a hadith narrated from him, hadith Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu ta'ala, Ahmed and Ibn Majah and Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi narrated it. The Prophet said, يُنضحُ بَوْلُ الْغُلَامِ وَيُغْسَلُ بَوْلُ الْجَارِيَةِ. The boy's urine is sprinkled and the girl's one is washed. So the girl's urine is washed and the boy is one is sprinkled. What boy are we talking about here? The one that has not fed food. He doesn't eat food. He's given what? He's just breast milk. And the girl that's given breast milk as well, her one's washed. Okay? This, some scholars took from this. Some scholars. They took from this that because the boy's one is a bit easier, because you just sprinkle water over it, and the girl's one you wash. Some of the scholars understood from that that the boy's urine is not najis. Well, it's incorrect. Are we all together? And that's why at the beginning I said to you that cleaning or removing the khabath or the najasa is those three types. It's either ghaslin or mashin or nadhin. Those are the three ways that the najasa is removed. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned walu'abu kalbin. The lu'ab of the dog is what? The lu'ab is the saliva of the dog. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Tuhuru ina'i ahadikum idha walagha fihi al-kalb." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Purify your utensils idha walagha fihi al-kalb, if the dog places his saliva." And what do? "An yaghsilahu sab'a marrat." The person washes it 7 times, ulahunna bit-turab. And the first one of it is with sand. Here the question here is the saliva of the dog prohibited because it's najis? We know that you have to wash it. But is it the saliva and what comes out of the dog's mouth, is it because it's najis why the Prophet ﷺ said that? Or it's ta'abbud? It's a form of ibadah. We'll answer that question, inshallah ta'ala, after the salah. Inshallah ta'ala.